This is Health Yeah, your weekly update on what's going on in the health, wellness, and medical world with Monica Robbins.
Having a baby is supposed to be one of the happiest times in a woman's life, but many women suffer from postpartum depression with feelings of sadness, anxiety, and hopelessness.
Excessive crying, distancing myself from the family, wanting to be alone.
We'll explore how this differs from the baby blues, and we'll try to erase the stigma surrounding postpartum depression. Plus, we want women to know there is hope available, including the first oral pill approved to treat PPD, but why you may not be able to get your hands on it.
The trouble is that they're extremely cost prohibitive, and most insurances, especially here in Louisiana, are not covering it.
It's all straight ahead on this week's edition of Prescription for Life. Welcome to Prescription for Life. I'm Monica Robbins. Being a mom is hard work. Your body and mind go through many changes during and after pregnancy. Postpartum depression, or PPD, describes a range of physical and emotional changes that many new mothers experience. You may feel sad, anxious, or overwhelmed, or even feel like you don't love or even care for your baby. If these symptoms last longer than 2 weeks, you may have postpartum depression. It's a serious medical condition that 1 in 8 women experience, according to the CDC. And this is more than just the baby blues. We'll explore that with our expert. But first, postpartum depression can look different for everyone. Leah Giddens is a mom of 2 and a lactation consultant. She experienced PPD after giving birth to both of her children. For her, in the beginning, motherhood wasn't easy.
With my postpartum depression experience, it was very different with both of my children. I felt like I was in a pit that I couldn't get out of.
The Georgia mom said it's important for women to have a plan for after the baby comes.
How are you going to feed yourself? How are you going to eat? Who's going to hold the baby, if need be, while you take a shower?
There is medication and counseling available for new moms. PPD can be different for everyone, especially for women of color. Faith Woodard talked with a woman who experienced changes within herself, not realizing those changes were signs of depression.
Try being a mom of 5 who just completed nursing school and is also running her own business.
The process is kind of long, and it's not just wax and wig and there you go. It has to be like chemistry in there.
Pouring ingredients into these containers is how Nikayla Jones makes her candles, and she says business is booming.
My favorite will be the pineapple sage. Mm-hmm.
10 out of 10. But what you don't know, starting this candle business and creating something that brought her peace and joy helped bring Jones out of postpartum depression.
Excessive crying, distancing myself from the family, wanting to be alone.
Jones says at first she didn't even realize her symptoms were a form of mental illness.
The lack of sleep, the lack of eating, the lack of concentration. My moods up and down, my excessive crying. And I said, I have to do something about this because it's making me and my family very uncomfortable.
Mariah Sumlin, a licensed counselor in Little Rock, says Black women in particular should pay closer attention when things don't feel normal.
With depressive symptoms, they can present in all type of ways. You know, high functioning depression is very common amongst not only African American women, but African American adolescents as well.
A recent New York University study revealed depression may be flying under the radar with Black women. It analyzed data from 227 Black women with children. Researchers screened them for depression as part of a larger study on high blood pressure. What the study found is that Black women reported symptoms of sleep disturbances, self-criticism, and irritability, not typical depression symptoms like feelings of hopelessness or depressed mood.
On the outside, they're doing everything great. Until, you know, you talk to them or they're willing to open up about those experiences, you'll never know.
The study also found that Black women with signs of depression also reported having a low sex drive, feelings of self-hate, hate and self-blame rather than those more common symptoms. Sumlin says another important factor in getting Black women the help they need is increased understanding of the uncommon symptoms they face.
One thing we practice in therapy is being able to actually listen to someone and interpret it in the way that they are saying it, and not in the way that you want to hear them say it. And when you do that, you're able to understand that person's experience uniquely for them.
Because of this, therapists are urging increased studies specifically focused on Black women to help expand access to care.
If you don't know the signs, then you don't know what to look for. And I told my husband prior to going into, especially the fifth child, watch me. Because if you see something off, we need to seek help.
As for Jones, her focus is on her family and her candle business.
It gives me a way not thinking about anything but candles, and I can just be free and do myself.
Her way of bringing light to others after going through her dark time.
For a closer look at the warning signs with yourself or someone you love, we turn to our expert. Joining me now is Dr. Laura Feldman, a psychiatrist with Cleveland Clinic who treats women with postpartum depression. And for so many years, it was largely ignored, or women were afraid to come forward because they felt some kind of guilt. Is that the case still? And exactly what is it?
Well, you're exactly right, Monica. We're hoping to destigmatize postpartum depression because it's actually a medical illness. And women should not feel ashamed or embarrassed to come forward because really it's very common and treatable.
Is it something that if a woman already deals with some form of depression or anxiety, they're more likely to develop this?
It's basically a major depressive episode that occurs after a woman gives birth, and it can actually develop in the third trimester. And basically, it's women can develop symptoms of irritability, crying episodes, and inability to bond with the baby. And it can progress to much more severe illness if it's not treated.
Is it often misdiagnosed? Because every woman and her hormones would probably say, yeah, I'm irritable in my third trimester, or, you know, right after I have no sleep. So is that one of the reasons? And what makes it severe enough that somebody should actually pay attention?
Well, about 85% of women experience a postpartum blues, which can last up to 2 weeks. And women can develop irritability, crying spells, feeling overly emotional, and they may have trouble with sleep. But when the symptoms persist beyond 2 weeks, then you want to seek medical attention, because we're going to be screening for postpartum depression after that, when it starts to really impair a woman's functioning and ability to take care of the baby and herself.
So what's typical treatment?
The typical treatment for postpartum depression traditionally has been antidepressants, which have been safe. There's many that are safe with pregnancy and postpartum, and safe with breastfeeding.
So what about the new drug that just came out, the FDA-approved drug? How common is it that you would prescribe that?
So zuranolone is thought to be a game changer, and basically it's a novel mechanism, unique, distinct from the other methods we've had to treat postpartum depression, and it's really been rapidly effective for women that have more moderate to severe postpartum depression.
How does it work? How's it administered?
Zuranolone is the first oral medication that's been FDA approved to treat postpartum depression. And before zuranolone, we had brexanolone, which was an IV form of the medication, which you had to come into the hospital for 3 days. And so now that we have this oral medication, which is FDA approved, it's going to be a game changer for women because it's so rapidly effective, and it can be taken at home.
From your perspective, you know, we've seen a rise in maternal and infant mortality. Is postpartum depression, does it play any role in that?
When it gets severe and it's left untreated, women can develop suicidal thoughts or thoughts of harming the baby even. So it's important to identify and treat it and be pretty aggressive with treatment. And we've developed screening protocols for women to have throughout the pregnancy and postpartum so we can identify it early and treat it.
Is there a known cause for it?
Well, hormonal shifts are one of the main causes, and the drug zuranolone is thought to reset the hormonal shifts and bring it back to normal. And it's actually within 3 days that a woman can start to feel much better. And it's an oral treatment that lasts 14 days.
So is there any particular group that's more susceptible?
Women that have had a history of anxiety or depression, particularly those that go off of their medication during pregnancy, are more susceptible. Women that have had a history of postpartum depression or those that have had a difficult pregnancy or difficult delivery. Women that have had exposure to domestic violence or have limited support are more likely to develop postpartum depression.
What about partners? What, you know, fathers? What can they do or what should they be looking for?
Well, they should be looking for the signs of postpartum depression, like irritability or lack of sleep, which can precipitate a mood episode to occur. And they should be, you know, saying, this doesn't seem like my wife. You know, unusual behavior, not showering, not bathing, not wanting to get out of bed, not wanting to be around family or do things that they normally do. You know, they should probably have the patient seek medical attention from their obstetrician or gynecologist or midwife.
Is the drug available to everyone?
Unfortunately, it's not. And we're hoping that the medication will be covered, like the drug brexanolone was covered by Medicaid, and most insurances fully covered. And when it wasn't covered, the drug company Sage helped cover the costs.
So if a woman can't get access to that medication or even the brexanolone medication, what options do they have?
Well, the treatment course is determined by your mental health provider, and there's many treatments for using antidepressants. Traditional antidepressants and therapy can be very helpful.
So if she doesn't want to take medication, there's cognitive behavioral therapy available?
Absolutely. Supportive therapy, you know, just getting moms together in group therapies that we've seen that women benefit from therapy greatly.
Does postpartum depression have any impact on kids as they grow up? Or if it's a girl, is she more likely to have it with her own child?
Well, it definitely is genetic, and moms that have family members that have had a history, a sister or a mother, are definitely more likely to have a postpartum depression. And the reason why we want to treat postpartum depression is because it can affect the infant maternal bond, which can affect child's development later on and in a negative way if it's not treated.
So your final thoughts, what do you want women to know?
I want them to know that it's a medical condition that's very treatable, and they shouldn't feel ashamed or embarrassed about having these symptoms.
Dr. Feldman, thank you so much for your insight. I think a lot of women are going to find a lot of peace hearing that there is hope. Thank you.
Thank you, Monica.
PPD can severely disrupt a person's ability to function. You heard some of the treatments that are available. Now to our TV station in New Orleans, where Meg Ferris takes a closer look and what you need to discuss with your doctor.
Studies are suggesting that natural hormone fluctuations are what trigger postpartum depression in women who are sensitive to the changes.
During pregnancy, our estrogen levels and progesterone levels are at an all-time high. And right before delivery, estrogen levels drop. And then right after delivery, progesterone levels significantly drop down to menopausal levels.
Oxner OBGYN Dr. Robin Bone says those female hormones are tied to your brain chemicals called neurotransmitters.
So when those levels are low, women have a heightened anxiety. They have more depression. They're more edgy and irritable. We see this also in postpartum patients as well as postmenopausal patients.
So in the last few years, a progesterone derivative came out. Brexinolone works fast, but it's by IV with 3 days in the hospital, costing as much as $34,000. Then just a few months ago, the pill version, zuranolone, came out. You take it at home once a day for 2 weeks, but this can cost $16,000. Both work and fast within a couple of days, returning brain chemistry back to normal.
The trouble is that they're extremely cost prohibitive, and most insurances, especially here in Louisiana, are not covering it. And oftentimes, even if they do cover it, they want you to try an SSRI first.
Those SSRIs are depression medications like Prozac and Zoloft. Doctors use them off-label to treat postpartum depression. Problem is, they may take many weeks to work. There are some doctors who, off-label, use very inexpensive regular progesterone pills like postmenopausal women use to help women with postpartum depression. Dr. Bone says the bottom line is don't suffer alone.
I think the important thing is for women to talk to their physician about their options. I also think it's very important if a patient does have postpartum depression is to talk to the insurance company.
Meg Farris, WWL, Louisiana.
What we learned today is that postpartum depression can be different for everyone, and it's important to talk with your loved ones, your doctor or pediatrician, about what you're feeling. You do not have to do this alone, and you certainly are not alone in feeling the way you do. If you're experiencing any kind of mental health issue, call or text 988 for the Suicide and Crisis Lifeline. That'll do it for this week's edition of Prescription for Life. Thank you so much for watching. We'll be back next week with another dose. Until then, I'm Monica Robbins, wishing you and yours good health.
Thank you so much for tuning into Health Yeah. Please find me on Twitter and Instagram at Monica Robbins. Like and follow my Facebook page, Monica Robbins WKYC. Find video podcasts at Monica Robbins' channel on YouTube. And please subscribe. Wishing you great health and hope to see you again soon.
Thanks for listening to Health Yeah with Monica Robbins from WKYC Studios. Subscribe now so you never miss an update. And find more on everything you heard here on WKYC.com and on the WKYC app.